Sorry.
In the beginning, when it was very dark, God said, "Let there be light." In the beginning, when it was very quiet, the Word was with God. When the time was right, God sent the Son. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Lord, speak to us, that we may hear your word. Move among us, that we may behold your glory. Receive our prayers, that we may learn to trust you. gospel calls us to turn away from sin and to be faithful to Christ. As we offer ourselves to him in love, we renew our confidence and trust in his mercy. We sit to pray. And we'll use the Kyrie on the following page. Friend of sinners, you bring hope in our despair. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Healer of the sick, you give strength in our weakness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Destroyer of evil, you bring life in our dying. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive us our sins and make us holy to serve him in the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and with our mouth we will praise our God. We might not be able to sing together this morning, but we can still go to the ancient songs, the Psalms. And this morning we have Psalm 42. So again, I invite you to stand if you're able, and we'll go through this psalm together. As the deer longs for the water brooks, so my soul longs for you, O God. My soul is thirsty, Lord, even for the living God. When shall I come before the presence of God? My tears have been my bread day and night, while all day long they say to me, where is now your God? Now when I think on these things, I pour out my soul, how I went with the multitude and led the procession to the house of God, with a voice of praise and thanksgiving among those who kept holy day. Why are you still full of happiness, O my soul? And why are you so disquieted within me? O put your trust in God, for I will yet give him thanks, who is the help of my countenance and my God. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
First reading is taken from the Old Testament. Taken from chapter 12, verses 1 to 14. And the reading may be found from the Pew Bible on page 68. The Lord said, Moses and Aaron in Egypt, this month is to be for you the first month of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of the month, each man is to take a lamb, for his family, one for each household. If any household is too small for a holy lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbour, having taken into account the number of people there are. You are to determine the amount of lamb needed in accordance with each person will eat. The animals you choose must be year-old males without defect, and you may take them the sheep or the goats. Take care of them until the 14th day of the month, when all the people of the community of Israel must slaughter them at twilight. Then they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and tops of the door frames of the houses where they eat the lambs. That same night they are to eat the meat roasted over the fire, along with bitter herbs and bread made without yeast. Do not eat the meat raw or cook in water, but roast it over the fire, head, legs, and the inner parts. Do not leave any of it till morning. If some is left till morning, you must burn it. This is how you are to eat it: with your cloak tucked into your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. On the same night I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both men and animals. And I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. This is a day you are to commemorate for the generations to come. You shall celebrate it as a festival of the Lord, a lasting ordinance. This is the very word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Is found on page 995 in the Bible, if you have one there. Dealing with sin in the church. So hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. If your brother or sister sins against you, go and show them their fault, just between you, between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along, so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If they refuse to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. I tell you the truth. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, I tell you that if two or three on earth agree with anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three come together in my name, there I am with them. This is the gospel of the Lord.
I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. What a strange pair of Bible readings we have this morning. Last week we heard about Moses and the burning bush, God calling Moses to lead his people to freedom. And today we have jumped several years, I think, straight into what happened the night before they escaped. We've missed all the drama about Moses and his brother Aaron pleading to Pharaoh to let his people go. And we've missed the story of the plagues. So So I thought it would be really good to start this morning by just casting our mind back and trying to remember all the plagues before the 10th plague that we've heard about today. I'm going to jog your memories. Can you think of those 9 other plagues? You're going to have to shout because I can't lip read from here, I'm afraid. Frogs, yes, that's the one we all remember, isn't it? Frogs.
Locusts?
The locusts.
I said
blood, yes, the rivers of blood. That's how many have we got? 3? Flies, boils, death of livestock. Are you reading my notes? My husband down here, hiding behind the pillar. I think we've got 2 more. Hail, yes. Death of the firstborn is the final plague, yes. And I've also got down here gnats. Apparently they're different to flies. And thunder along with the hail, apparently, if it couldn't get worse. And you know, I don't think there's been a time in our lives, in living memory, when we've been able to really relate to the idea of a plague in the Bible. And whilst this coronavirus pandemic is pretty bad, I'm really glad it didn't start with rivers of blood or plagues and frogs. So let's be thankful for something. So this reading from the book of Exodus, this first account of the Jewish Passover meal, I think we can read with fresh eyes. Here are families, terrified of the plague going on around them. Terrified they or their loved ones might die from an unseen threat. Does that sound familiar? And this is a story of an oppressed people, enslaved and marginalized, and all they can do is hope that if they follow their leader's instructions, it will save them. So what is God's plan? He gives instructions to each family. There's no corporate ritual or gathering when Moses performs some great ceremony. There's no special sanctuary for them to go to or public altar for them to make a sacrifice. They've not been invented yet. God is interested in the intimate family meal. And they're given strict instructions on how and when to prepare a roast lamb dinner. Each household must follow the instructions, and if the family is small, they can join another family. Immediately, there is provision. If your household is small, join with another one. We have a word for that now, don't we? Sound familiar? A family bubble. Is this the first bubble in the Bible? A Bible bubble, yes. But there is a sense of togetherness and community as they do the same thing at the same time on a given day. And again, I think we can relate to that, perhaps in a way we never have done before. Doing things together, even if we're physically apart. God has seen the suffering of his people. But he's not going to whisk them away or magic them out of the situation. Instead, he's asking them to act, to respond. Moses may be the leader, Aaron may be the mouthpiece, but the command is for each family, each household to respond in faith. Only if they all participate will they all be saved. So God instructs the people to do 3 things. To prepare a meal, put some blood from the prepared lamb on the sides and lintels of their doors, and to be dressed and ready to go. The relationship between the Israelites and their God is not abstract or distant. God wants to relate to each household, each social bubble. God is zooming in on the family. He asks that they gather to eat in his name And the way they roast that lamb might remind them of how their ancestor Abraham made sacrifices to the Lord. God asks that they mark their houses out as belonging to him. And by participating in this action, they are asking God to shield them. It is a visible sign of spiritual purification and protection. And thirdly, God asks that they are ready to go, dressed, shoes on, walking stick in hand, ready to go where he sends them. So what can that mean for us? For us whose social lives and spiritual practice might have shrunk to the size of a household or social bubble. Everything has been stripped back for us over these past few months. Yet here we see that God cares about our situation, how we relate to each other, and how we relate to him. And we might have become more familiar with the idea of worshipping at home. And it's wonderful to see many of you here today, but there are still several who cannot or feel unable to gather in public spaces. So what might it mean to worship in a bubble? Can two households gather and that be church? And even though we are gathered in church again, it's not quite the same as it was. When how we practice our faith is stripped back, what are we left with? I think we heard the answer in our gospel reading. Where two or three gather in my name, there I am with them, says Jesus. God promises to be present with us, whether we gather in large numbers or small numbers, and it doesn't specify what kind of building we need to be in. When our faith and our practice is stripped right back, all we're left with is Jesus. There's a lot more I could say about that second Bible reading. Some of it is rather odd, but for now, it's important to notice that somehow, when two or three people worship or pray together, that is a place where heaven and earth join. The God who designed the family Passover meal is the same God who continues to be present whenever people gather together and give Jesus a seat at the table. What God asked the Israelites to do was actually quite simple. And God is concerned that we all participate, men and women, young and old. I think it's a call to simplicity, to follow Jesus, keep things simple, mark our lives out as belonging to him, and be ready to enter into uncharted territory. This might be a physical journey, it might be a spiritual one. What will we take with us, and what will we leave behind? What do we need from God to strengthen us for the journey? What do we have to offer in response to his call? We're going to have a song now. We do have a guest singer, which is lovely. Steph has joined us this morning, and Lynn's going to play, which picks up the theme of keeping worship focused on Jesus. If you know it, you're welcome to mouth the words behind your mask or to hum along. Either way, let's take these few minutes and these words to respond to God in our hearts this morning.
Away.
invite you now to stand if you're able to declare together our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated as we have a time of prayer.
Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we praise you that you are with us, not simply when life is easy and carefree, but in the darkness, the emptiness, and those times when we feel lost and uncertain. Though you have never promised that life would be easy without pain or problems, you have assured us that you will be with us. We praise you that no matter who we are, where we go, or what we are facing, your almighty presence never leaves us. We praise you for your gentle understanding of our doubts and our fears. We praise you most for Jesus Christ and for the way that in him you shared in our suffering. That you are not a God who is content to sit on the sidelines of life. In Christ you entered into a world of pain and loss. We praise you that he is the only one who can say that he does know how we feel, and that he fully understands what life costs us. We remember how he began life in the poverty of a stable. Through his life, he was dependent on others, for friendship and food, for anointing and a donkey, for a cross and a tomb. Lord, help us to praise him, even when we are alone or afraid, rejected or overwhelmed by demands made upon us, lost or frustrated, confused or just hurting. Help us to praise him, for he enters even our pain. Amen. We pray for all those affected by coronavirus in the world. We pray for world leaders who will have to make difficult decisions in these unprecedented times. We particularly pray for people who live in the poorer countries, where the pandemic has contributed to an already difficult situation, and where social distancing is almost impossible. Dear Lord, we pray that you will grant wisdom to the leaders of nations, both individually and collectively, so that their countries may come through the pandemic with a minimum loss of life and disruption to their economies. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We thank you, Lord, for the work of the NHS workers, who selflessly put in the maximum effort to save lives, especially at the peak of the pandemic, and put their own lives at risk in doing so. We also pray for teachers, lecturers and their pupils who are having to return to the places of education with procedures designed to minimise the risk of infection. Dear Lord, we pray that you will be with those who work in the NHS and grant them the skills and wisdom to treat those with coronavirus and any other illnesses that present themselves. Also that you will give confidence to both teachers and pupils so they are able to learn effectively under the new regimes and be able to catch up as much as possible with the learning which they missed during lockdown. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We thank you, Lord, for the other workers who continue to work during lockdown, providing essential services such as care workers, funeral services, the police, shop workers, farm workers, and those on public transport. Also for the clergy and lay members who have continued to provide guidance and counselling during the pandemic, as well as online worship services for those who are able to access them. We pray that we will be able to resume normal worship as soon as it is safe to do so. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, we know that it appears that the worst of the pandemic in this country might be over, but it is likely that the worst of the effect on our economy and jobs is yet to come. We pray for businesses that continue to struggle to exist in the current environment, particularly in the entertainment and leisure industries, and for employees whose jobs are threatened, particularly when the furlough scheme comes to an end. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Finally, we pray for ourselves. Dear Lord, the pandemic has brought new challenges to all of us in different ways. Whether we are elderly and have needed to isolate against possible infection, missing contact with family and friends, we may be working and running a business or have a job in a difficult environment. We may be a student who has missed out on several weeks of education. Whatever our situation, help us to remember that we are your children and you love and guide us. Help us to continue to live our lives in the Christian way and to be a source of hope and comfort for others that we meet, a beacon of your light through the darkness. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son.
Amen. The collect for today, the church's prayer for this day. Almighty God, you search us and know us. May we rely on you in strength and rest on you in weakness, now and in all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And gathering all our prayers and praises into one, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let me leave you with God's blessing. In fact, let's say this together. To each other. The love of the Lord Jesus draw us to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen us in his service. The joy of the Lord Jesus fill our hearts. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen. Lord, by your cross we are redeemed. Send us out to live for you. Lord, your word is our rule and guide. Send us out to follow you. Lord, you are the light of the world. Send us out to shine for you. Go in peace to love and serve the